They were Indiana University's first women's basketball teams in the varsity era. They also happened to be the most accomplished, becoming a varsity sport in the fall of 1971. In their first 4 years of competing, the Hoosiers won 81% of their games, went to the Elite Eight in 1972 and 1974, and the AIAW Final Four in 1973. And now their incredible accomplishments are immortalized from the rafters of Assembly Hall.
It was a great period of time. I love basketball. I love coaching. The student athletes that I had the chance to work with were the best. And I would not trade that for any experience that came before or after in my career. And for that, I'll always be grateful. It's irreplaceable. My time at IU was tremendous and the best. So I don't think I can top that.
Well, they were the pioneers. Without them blazing the path back in the day, we wouldn't be IU women's basketball now.
It was very different. It was a really a great time of innocence. You play because you wanted to play. You play because you enjoyed your teammates. And I think there were a lot of virtuous friendships formed at that time where you became a better person by being with who you were with on that floor. You were not about to disappoint your teammates.
I loved playing basketball at Indiana. I loved going to Indiana University. It was just a fabulous time. The players on the team were my best friends, and we had a lot of fun. We had a great coach. We worked really hard, and it was thrilling to go to the Final Four, to play in that arena.
The catalyst for these remarkable teams was a brilliant young graduate student with a strong sports background. Bea Gorton became IU's first head coach. She got the job in the most unusual of circumstances.
I had gone to Indiana with the purpose of going to grad school for a doctorate in biomechanics. My advisor, Dr. John Cooper, knew that they had a need for a women's basketball coach. So he said, Bea, he said, I've got an opening for you for a basketball coach. Would you be the basketball coach? So I had an assistantship in the women's physical education department. And so I was wondering, can I do grad school, do a graduate assistantship, and be a head basketball coach? But with his encouragement, I said yes. There was no pay, none at all. It was part of the graduate assistantship assignment.
To comprise those first Indiana teams, Gorton had to employ a recruiting model far different from what is common practice today.
Our recruitment was putting up flyers over campus buildings and saying we're holding open tryouts for the women's basketball team. There were no monies for recruitment, and we didn't travel at all. And I, as a grad student with my schedule, actually didn't have time. We really didn't know about players at different schools either. At that point in time, only some schools had much of a women's high school basketball program for the women athletes. And so we basically just learned about the athletes as they arrived on campus and then came for tryouts. So the first year, we actually took anybody that came for the tryouts. The second year, we limited the roster, and we actually had either two or three, quote, B games. And then the third year, that sort of got phased out, and we just had varsity team. So it just became sort of word of mouth.
So I was at the Hyper building a lot, and we used to go and just pick up games. And so I would just go with friends of mine, we'd go and pick up games and play with some of the girls, women there. And I guess I was just basically a little bit good enough that some of the players who had played the year before asked me, said I should just come on out and try out for the team. So I did, and I made it.
One of the more fortuitous recruiting scores took place on the campus of Illinois State University at the 1972 tournament.
The first year the national tournament was at Illinois State University. And it was that year that Tara came and to Illinois State to watch the tournament, see the different schools, talk to players. And I did not know it at the time, but she told us later that she talked to different players from different schools, and it was because of the contact of the players of Indiana that she chose to come to Indiana University.
I actually transferred to Indiana after my freshman year, and I transferred because I watched the team play at the AIAW National Championship the year before, and I watched them, and I try to have players, I want to have the same camaraderie, that I want to emulate the experience that I had at Indiana with our Stanford teams now.
Long before charter flights, nice hotels, catered pregame meals, women's basketball teams in the early 1970s had to fend for themselves.
We would get a university van, and basically my remembrance is that I would drive the van to whichever school we played the game. So we'd get to the school, I don't know if it'd be an hour before the game or a little bit more. And then we'd have our time to have warm up and would turn our attention to getting ready to be prepared for the game and the coach.
We usually took vans and drove university cars. We didn't fly, you know, charters like the guys did or anything.
They had to travel. They probably figured out they probably had two cars. We had two cars. One was a smoking car, one was a non-smoking car, you know. I'm not going to tell you which one I was in.
In those days, if I remember, we might have been given $2 per player to help toward the cost of our meals. And so we'd stop at, you know, a favorite place of that the players had chosen to grab a bite to eat and either eat there or take it in the van and then eat on our way home so we'd get home a little bit sooner.
Gorton's teams were blessed with the best backcourt in school history, with Hall of Famers Tara Vandeveer and the program's only ever Kodak All-American, Debbie Owing, who averaged over 22 points per game her senior season.
And we had one of the best guard tandems that I think IU's probably ever had between she and Debbie Owing. Because Debbie was, I think, the first, and I don't know that you've had another All-American at Indiana yet. Hopefully that'll come.
Tenacious. I mean, she could break you down in a minute. I mean, she was very a great floor general, and she knew what she had to do. She knew where you needed to go, and you knew where you wanted to go when you were playing with her. So it was kind of like, she led the team, and like I said, she was the floor general of the team when I played with her.
I would say Tara was more of a shooting guard, and Debbie the defensive player. I don't know how many times she could get a steal and then a clean breakaway and score a layup off of it.
When you put her and Debbie, as we used to call her, Ding, together, I would probably say they were probably the two of the most players that were unstoppable. When their game was on, you couldn't stop either one of them.
Owing and Vandeveer's efforts were buttressed by a tremendous front court. Georgia Hone, Sheila Northcutt, Sammy Winchester, and Carol Kegley gave Indiana a tremendous presence down low.
We had some really strong players in the front court, strong, steady players that just blended and contributed to the team. The thing about the team was there was no individual egos. They were all playing for the benefit of the team. They were hardworking, disciplined, especially during practices. And it really showed up during the games.
And I'm really thankful to have played with so many great players. Again, Debbie Owing, Debbie Milburn, Georgia Hohen, Lou Stevenson, so many of the great players. I'm very thankful for that opportunity.
The Hoosiers were battle-tested come tournament time due to an abundance of strong teams in Indiana and in the Midwest in general.
So prior to Title IX, large and small was not a factor in the strength of the team. And so Indiana State was a huge rival for us, and actually stronger than, say, a Purdue University was at that time.
And we played great competition. Indiana State at the time was a really good team. Franklin, a lot of small Indiana schools were very good.
I would almost say I think we probably beat Purdue basically most of the times that we played them, but it was Indiana State, and we'd go to tournaments and they would be held up at Franklin. And so, yeah, those were basically our two big rivals in the state when I played.
Qualifying for the national tournament in New York provided the players of that era with the experience of a lifetime.
On our travel that year, the IU Foundation plane flew us to New York. And it was the first time some of the athletes had flown. So it was those are memories you don't forget.
For me personally, going to the Final Four was as good a basketball memory as I have. And, coaching in the Olympics and winning national championships, playing in the Final Four and playing with the players I played with at Indiana ranks right there with that.
The tournament format was grueling. And in 1 year, the Hoosiers played 3 games in less than 24 hours.
We knew that it was a 16-team format at both regional and national. The national had 10 teams which qualified through tournament play, and then 6 teams at large. But you knew that you would be playing back-to-back-to-back days. And when we were in the New York tournament, the way our bracket and the time slots fell, we actually played 3 games in a 24-hour period. And our third game, we played Queens, and we got beat pretty soundly. I have to feel there was a little bit of home court advantage in that. Our players were sleeping on the benches in the locker room before the third game. We grabbed some food in the cafeteria, and I have to think, some of the Queen players could have at least slept in the dorms where we didn't have that advantage. Our manager, Nancy Petrick, and myself went out and washed the uniforms between the games so we'd have clean uniforms to play that next game.
Well, back in the day, actually, we played 2 games in 1 day, and I just remember being exhausted. If nothing else, I think it really helped me as a coach to understand the importance of conditioning and being in great shape.
The Hoosiers more than held their own against the sport's first dynasty, Immaculata, losing twice to the eventual champions by razor-thin margins.
And they were our nemesis. I can remember both games. I think the first game we lost by 3 points, and the next time around we faced them, we lost by 4 points. We just could not turn the tables on them. And both years, they went on to win the national tournament. So we were close, very close.
I was underneath the basket, and I usually drew a double team. And when I played, my arms were always up. I just played like that. And I turned around into a double team, and I caught one of the Indiana players with my elbow here. And of course, they bleed quite profusely from that particular point in this person. I certainly didn't mean to swing. It wasn't a swing. It was just she came under and caught. And, the fans were brutal. They were screaming, "Shank, how's that feel now? Blah, 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 blah." And I'm thinking, oh, my gosh, I really need this. Like, I need a hole in the head. I hope she's all right.
Miss free throw here, bad call there. We were in every game we played, especially against Immaculata. It just seemed kind of funny that we always seemed to draw them either in the second or the third round. We were always in the bracket with them. We never could come up the other way and maybe meet them in the semifinals or something. So we always knew it was going to be a tough way to go with our draw.
The early years of IU women's basketball are now being justly celebrated. They have laid the groundwork for the incredible women who have followed, and for all of the special moments the program has experienced along the way.
Too quick to get anything off. Alley-oop to Thomas at the buzzer! How wrong am I? They toss the ball underneath the cup! Wendy Thomas volleyballs it off the window for two! Indiana wins 59-57! Down one with a chance to win it with the ball. I think he would have taken it. Inbound to Sasha Chaplin. That's not where Indiana wants to be. Nicole Bell's got to work her way up court against Dee Dee Williams. Who's going to take the shot? Who's going to get the shot? It's going to be Jasmine McGee. 2 seconds left. Jasmine elevates, jumper, buries it! She knocks it down! Indiana has upset Purdue! The Indiana Hoosiers have upset Purdue! Jasmine McGee, the hero!
Rebound to Ogoka. Larry Brooks is going to strip it away. Down to Girona, back to Brooks. Left the defender! Laren gets a screen. She's going to snake to the goal. Muscles up the shot, banks it in! She is Laren Brooks. Extra pass to Deloge. Nice one, too. She rumbles in the low block.
The Hoosiers of 1971 through 1974, the greatest era ever for IU women's basketball. A team for all time.